Amen. Greet your neighbor in the name of the Lord this morning. As you make your way back to your seats, if you'll turn over on the back of your bulletins, we do have an announcement to make sure that you remember that right after church this morning, they are having a fundraising lunch for Mac Purtle. At the high school cafeteria. It's a pancake luncheon, and your donations and support for Mac will be greatly appreciated. He is home now. He got home, I think, Thursday or Friday. He's resting, trying to, you know, recuperate. He still can't talk above a whisper, and still has some issues going on, but he is back home, and that's a joy for us to know that he's back here. And I've encouraged him not to come to the luncheon because of all the flu and strep throat stuff going around, but you know Mac, he may show up anyway. He's kind of stubborn like that. So just wanted you to know that he is back home, but here, your donations would help him a lot because he was in Dallas for quite a while and has a lot of bills that he's going to need to be able to pay. So your support would be appreciated. Also wanted to let you know that we had flu in our family this last week. Briley had the flu, and so I'm going to refrain from shaking hands and giving hugs this morning, just in case. I don't have any symptoms or anything, but I don't want anybody to catch flu because of me. So if I'm not being standoffish, that's just why we're doing that, because I know none of you want that. So are there any other announcements that we need to lift up this morning? Okay, what joys can we lift up today? What are we happy about? George Calvin Self is back home now. All right, that's a joy. Yes, ma'am.
I have a new great-grandson with a horrible name. Nathan Oaken Quaid.
Oaken Quaid, okay. New great-grandson, all right, for Carla Rose. That's a joy. What else? Yes, sir. Your grandma had a stroke, but she's getting better from that. That is a joy. Yes, sir. That is a joy. You bet. Any other joys to lift up today? All right. If you'll take a moment then and look at your list of prayer concerns. Do we have any additions or updates to anyone on our prayer list today? All right, well, yes. Austin Cole. Okay, they got him a motorized wheelchair. All right, good. That's wonderful. He's able to drive that motorized wheelchair by himself and get around by himself. You bet. Thank you for that update, Joanne. Yes? Okay, well, Rob will be praying that we find some answers. Yes, sir. Anything else this morning? All right, well, let's prepare our hearts to go to the Lord in prayer.
Lord, prepare me. to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you.
Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this day that we can come into your house, fellowship with one another, sing praises to you, and hear your word. We pray that you would open our hearts and minds to receive the word that you have for us today. May it strengthen us, challenge us, teach us, and give us a boldness to leave this place and be your disciples to the world around us. We thank you for the blessings in our lives, all the joys that were lifted up this morning, and even those that are in our hearts today. And we just ask that you would help us to always remember to give you thanks and praise for the good and wonderful gifts in our lives. We lift up these on our prayer list this morning. We pray for the fundraiser that's going to be happening after church for Mac. Lord, we just pray that he would experience an extravagant outpouring of support and love from this community. Our way of showing God's love to him in a very practical way. Lord, we lift up Rob to you as well. Lord, we just pray that you would give him relief from the pain in his back and that you would just guide the doctors as they seek to determine the cause of the discomfort and pain that he's feeling. We lift up every person on this list. And we pray that they would feel your presence in a mighty way this morning. And that if we see names here, Lord, that we would be inspired to reach out to them in some way this week and show them the love of Christ. We pray for this community. We pray for those who are waking up this morning not knowing what it feels like to have a family of faith. Not knowing what it feels like to have brothers and sisters in Christ who are there to support and guide and direct. For those who are feeling all alone in this world, we pray that you would help us through our actions this week to be a light in the darkness for them. We pray for this nation. We pray that you would bring unity, that you would help us heal the divisions in our land, that you would just guide our leaders, help them to have the wisdom to seek your guidance in all that they do. And Lord, we pray for our world. So many are innocent victims of terror and war. And we pray that you would just bring deliverance for them. For our brothers and sisters in Christ who are being persecuted and even killed for their faith, we pray that you would deliver them from harm's way. And that you would bring peace. And when we come to those times in our lives when we don't know what to say or even how to pray, help us remember we can always pray with confidence. The prayer you taught your disciples when you prayed. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now we're going to have some special music this morning from George and Hannah Keeter.
I think you'll know the words.
Just said them.
Oh.
Hallowed be. To temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory
very much. As they're returning to their seats, if the little children will come, we'll have our children's message this morning.
Take some out of there and then put it back in.
I don't.
Okay, here. Take some out, put it back in.
Can I say something?
Yeah, first? Let's put our money in though. You got another dollar in your hand? All right, put it in there. Who else? Money? Okay, Rear, what you got?
I got.
What you got to say?
My mom and my dad used to give me some jelly beans.
Wonderful. What color? What's your favorite color?
Purple.
Purple. Mine's green. What's your favorite color?
I don't really have
green too.
Who's is?
Larry's is green.
Green too. What's your favorite color?
My mom,
blue.
My mom. I think my mom likes green.
Oh, okay. Here we go.
I think my mom likes green too.
My mom
likes blue.
Your mama likes blue.
And
Michelle,
I,
do you like blue?
No. I like blue.
You like blue. Okay.
I like.
Hey, can you count to 10?
I can.
Can you count to 10?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
One more.
10.
10. All right. That's what we're talking about today.
10. 10. Lemon. Bye.
10, yes. All right. We have. Can you say. Come here. Can you say 10 commandments?
I can.
Let's see if you say that. You want
to?
Say Moses.
Moses.
We talked about Moses today. Do you know who he is? Who's Moses?
A head.
He was a little baby in a basket, wasn't he, at one time? But today we talked about Moses, and somebody told Moses to go somewhere. Who was it? God said what?
Go to the top of the mountain, and there's some tablets.
I will give you the tablets. And Trevor, the Bible verse. Where do you find it?
Chapter 20.
Exodus 20. Okay. Now we have something we're going to do. Is there anything? Anything else? Okay.
I
shouldn't have said that.
All
right.
So y'all, you little ones, just sit right here on the floor. You little babies. Here, hand out your. Here, let me hand them out. All right. Who has one? You have one and two. Who has three? Four? Four and five. Six? Six and seven. Eight, nine, and ten. Can you offer them? All right, get in order behind these kids. Okay? Remember your order? One's right here. Isn't it? Which one would one be?
It doesn't matter.
Okay. All right. We're going to put one on this end. All right. Here we go. We got the Ten Commandments, and they've been playing games and learning the Ten Commandments. Okay.
You shall have no other gods.
Is it on?
Yes.
Okay. Now.
You shall have no other gods.
Okay. That's number one. Tell them what number it is.
Number one. Number two. You shall not make adults. I don't know.
Idols. That's a new word. Idols. Okay. What number do you have, Trevor?
I have nine.
Oh, you need to go way down here. All right. Who has two and three? Who has two and three? Come here. There you go. Okay. Tell them. Hold your picture up and tell them your number.
Three. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord.
I turn them around and show them your pictures. Okay. What do you have? Four.
Remember the Sabbath. Keep it holy.
And we learned what the Sabbath was today. What's the Sabbath? Sunday.
Five. Honor your father and mother.
Okay.
Six. You shall not murder. Seven. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal.
Let's have a help because Cannon left.
Nine. You shall not lie. 10. You shall not commit covet.
And those are the what? 10 commandments. All right. Let's turn around here. Put your heels up. Let's all hold hands and say a prayer. Hey, young ones, come on. Come up here and let's hold hands. Hold hands with somebody. You know, you can stand up if you want to. Help somebody go. There you go. Everybody got a hand? Okay. All right. Dear Heavenly Father, we love these children. And we love that their spirits bring them to Sunday school every Sunday. We love our fellowship with them. Please watch over us this day and this week. And thank you, Lord, for giving us the very first Valentine's because you love us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
As the children are returning to their seats, if we could have some ushers gather in the back, we'll take our morning offering. Let's pray. God, we just pray that you would bless our offering, that you would help us to give with cheerful hearts, knowing that the funds that we give are being used to minister to our children, for outreach in our community, to help folks like Mac, and all the many things that we do for the kingdom here in Throckmorton and around the world. We just pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Please rise to the doxology.
Praise God from
You may be seated. I once knew a boy named Rick who had abandoned the faith. Rick was a ninth grader when I came to know him in the youth ministry that I was serving in. And as I learned from some of the other kids in the youth group, before I arrived there, Rick's parents had gone through quite a long struggle in their marriage. And Rick had prayed and asked for prayers and prayed week after week after week and month after month that his parents would not get a divorce. But one day his dad walked in and told him that they were. And Rick was devastated and he was angry. He said things like, "Well, why bother even praying if God is not going to listen to me? Is there even a God to hear me anyway? I've never asked God for anything before, and the one time that I do, nothing happens." And he abandoned the faith. We talked last week about authentic faith. We began a discussion and we talked about what authentic faith is not. And one of the scriptures that we had was from the book of Proverbs, and it's kind of a hard verse for us sometimes because we want to know the answers and we want to be in control and we want to know everything. But Proverbs chapter 3 verses 5 through 6 tells us plainly that we should trust in the Lord with all our heart and lean not on our own understanding. In all your ways submit to Him and He will make your paths straight. And we talked about how many people have a misconception of what biblical faith is, and we talked about how it is not a force or a power that we can tap into to get God to do whatever we want Him to do. It's not God owing us for being good and following all the rules. And faith is not tied to our present feelings or circumstances. So what then is biblical faith? Well, I want to take us back to the book of Hebrews because it's a wonderful book about biblical faith. And then according to the writer, in chapter 11, verse 1, he says, "Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see." A famous Christian pastor and author, his name is Andy Stanley, he defined faith this way. He said, "For me, a good working definition of faith is this. Faith is confidence that God is who He says He is and that He will do all He has promised to do." Faith is confidence that God is who He says He is and that He will do all He has promised to do. You see, our confidence can't be in ourselves or in our friends or in our family. Our confidence can't be in our circumstances or even in the church or in the pastor because eventually people let us down. People can't be perfect and they hurt our feelings sometimes. They don't mean to sometimes, but they let us down. In Hebrews chapter 11, the writer gives dozens of illustrations of people who showed authentic biblical faith. And in every case, that faith was grounded in a promise or a revelation from God. We talked about Noah, who spent 120 years building an ark simply because God promised that it was going to rain. Abraham left his home and set out with no destination in mind, simply because God promised to lead him to a new home. Gideon charged into an enemy camp, incredibly outnumbered, because God had promised him a victory. And Joshua marched around Jericho until the walls fell down, because God had promised him success. See, unfortunately, many people resist this kind of a definition of faith, because we when we're honest with each other, we really want to be in control. We want to be in the driver's seat. It's okay for God to ride along shotgun and help us out along the way, but we want to be in control. I mean, I know I've struggled with this in my own walk many times. When I was younger, I was always trying to find a way, a gimmick, some magic prayer that would make God do what I wanted Him to do. But biblical faith puts God firmly in control of our lives. And authentic biblical faith leaves God the option to say no. See, as long as we're trying to get something from God, we're going to have a hard time surrendering our lives to God. Now, we've seen examples of how people in the Old Testament times showed authentic faith. But what does that look like for us in the New Testament church? See, we have to remember that, like truth, the foundation of biblical faith, it's not linked to us, our circumstances, our feelings, or our opinions. The foundation of biblical truth is the Bible, the Word of God. But the foundation of the Christian faith is a person. And that person is Jesus Christ. I keep coming back to the book of Hebrews when discussing issues of faith, because Hebrews was written to a group of Christians who were being pressured by their community and some tough circumstances around them to abandon the faith. And the writer of Hebrews is encouraging his readers to keep believing on the basis of the identity of Christ. He takes the first three chapters and he gives a mountain of evidence pointing toward the conclusion that Christ is truly God. And he concludes by saying in chapter 4, verse 14, he says, "Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith that we profess." See, Christians must base their faith on the identity of Christ. Because if Christ really is who He says He is, then you don't have to worry when bad things happen to you. You have a high priest who understands. If Jesus really did die for your sins, then you don't have any reason to doubt His love. You have a friend who laid down His life for you. And if Jesus really meant it when He promised to come back for you, then you don't have to be afraid what comes next. You have a heavenly Father who has your best interests in mind. Last week I noted that tragedy is often behind the destruction of a person's faith. But most of the time, the underlying cause is actually unmet expectations. Remember Rick, the kid who prayed that his parents wouldn't get divorced? Here's what was really going on with him. See, as he prayed and as he asked for prayers, his expectations increased. And as his expectations increased, his faith increased. I mean, they're still arguing, but they're still together, so maybe it's going to work out. And he keeps praying, and his expectations keep rising, and his faith keeps rising because he just thinks, yeah, at any point they're going to get back together. And then Dad walks in and announces that the divorce is going to happen anyway. So he's devastated. What's the point? Why pray? Where is God? Why would He let me down like this? Or maybe it's like Jim and Sarah, whose son was critically injured in a car accident. As he struggles for life in the ICU, his parents, friends, family members, and church members pray, and they pray hard for his healing. And with each passing day, their expectations increase, and as their expectations increase, so does their faith. I mean, he's hanging on, right? Maybe, just maybe. 5 days later, Jim and Sarah's son dies. And his parents are devastated. They too wonder, what's the point in praying? Is God even there? Why would He take our young son from us? See, the last thing that Rick and Jim and Sarah need to feel in this time of crisis is isolation from God. This is when they need to cling to God more than ever. Yet their expectations and faith have set them up for disappointment with God. And as a result, they feel like that they're just going to handle this disappointment alone, without Him. You've seen this, haven't you? Maybe you've even experienced it yourself. Something bad happens to someone, and almost immediately you notice that they isolate themselves. They leave the church. They leave their family of faith. And they even leave God just when they need God and their church family the most. You see, we have to be able to distinguish between God's promises and our own expectations. There's so many things that God has not promised that we wish He had. See, God has not promised to keep bad things from happening to you. He has not promised to heal every illness. And He has not promised to reverse the consequences of sin. Yeah, at times miracles happen. And we see those things happen, but that's why they call them miracles. They're just rare interventions from God. And we don't understand and we don't know why. But they happen. But those aren't promises. A miracle is not a promise. God is under no obligation. And the fact that parents divorce and children die and friends move away is no reflection on the goodness or the presence of our Heavenly Father. See, one of the best examples to look at is the apostles. The guys that walked around with Jesus while He was on earth. I mean, you couldn't find, men and women of greater faith than these guys. But God didn't always intervene for them. He didn't free them from difficulty. But an answer of no from God did not destroy their faith. Because they understood that the foundation of their faith was not always getting the answer they wanted. Their faith was grounded in Christ. So what can we expect from God? What has He promised? Again, the writer of Hebrews helps us by identifying the two things that we can always expect. And man, if you don't hear another thing I say this morning, hear this. These are the two things that He promises that He will always give us. Listen to the writer in Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 through 16. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet He did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Did you catch what those two things were? The two things that God's always going to give us? The two things He's always going to give us in our most critical times of need are His mercy and His grace. In this context, mercy is just means the understanding that Jesus knows exactly how we feel. We have a high priest who empathizes with us. He knows what we're going through. And He's going to walk with us through whatever the trial or struggle we're in right now. And then His grace. In this context, it is the strength to endure. The ability to carry on. Mom may never understand. Dad may never come back. The test may come back positive. The bank may still foreclose. Our loved one may still be taken from us too soon. But God has promised to give us His grace, the strength to endure, the ability to carry on. He has not promised to deliver you from your circumstances, but He has promised to deliver you through them. And you have the freedom and confidence to approach God and ask Him and tell Him anything. And you can count on Him for the grace to endure in the meantime. See, if people build their faith on anything other than that, if they build their faith on anything other than Jesus Christ, who He is and what He has done for them, then they are building their faith on a very fragile foundation. Eventually, the choices of life will sway them to adapt or compromise what they believe. Circumstances will cause them to doubt God. But God never intended for their faith to rest upon what's going on around them. So what about you this morning? On what foundation have you built your faith? You see, it's going to be really hard for us to go from this place and make disciples if our faith is not rooted in the right foundation. And I pray that as we close this day, you will examine your heart and examine your life and make sure that your faith is grounded in the person of Jesus Christ and nothing else. Nothing else. And if you're in the midst of the struggle right now, may you experience His mercy and His grace to endure. And even if things don't work out the way you expect, may you never doubt His presence to help you through whatever it is you're going through. And please also don't ever doubt that you have a church family right here who loves you and supports you and wants to help you through it. I can't imagine not having a church family. I don't know about you, but it's hard for me to fathom waking up in the morning and truly feeling like you're all alone. Yet there's people out here in this community each and every day who wake up feeling that way. You're not alone. You're not alone. Last week I asked you to write down some names of some people maybe who are struggling in their faith. Maybe they have a misconception of what true faith is. And I pray that you would continue to be praying for them and praying for opportunities to have conversation with them. Have opportunities to share with them what it truly means to have faith in God. Or maybe you've never really allowed Jesus to be in control of your life. Oh, you play a good game. You've got everybody fooled. You do church really well. But maybe you're still hanging on to certain areas of your life and you haven't given God the driver's seat in every area of your life. I pray that as we close this morning, you'll say, okay, that's enough. I'm tired of trying to drive, God. I need you to take the wheel in every area of my life. Give Him your life so that He can be in the driver's seat, so He can take you where He needs for you to go. As we close this morning, this altar's open. It's always open. If you need prayer, come. I'll be happy to pray with you right here and always available to pray with you, talk with you, walk through life with you. So if you need it, please give me a call, a text, email, whatever. We're here for each other, to help each other through. Let's pray. God, we come to you this morning and I'm thankful. I'm thankful that you loved me so much that you sent your Son so that I might have a relationship with you through Him. I pray, God, that you would search every heart in this room and that you would just reveal to us anything that is not of you. Help us to give control of our lives to you so that you can shape us and mold us into the men and women you've called us to be. Help us to know that your grace and your mercy is always there to help us through the trials of life. And even though we may not understand, and even though we may question, and even though we may be hurt and even angry, Lord, you're still there to guide us through. Help us to also know that we have a church family who loves us and cares about us. So help us not to think that we have to keep our struggles secret, but that we might find brothers and sisters in Christ here that we can share our burdens with, so that we can walk through them together. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Our closing song this morning is titled Glorious Day. Words will be provided for you on the screen. I ask you to rise and join in singing Glorious Day. Great stuff. Start over.
Filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as it could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh, the light shines among us, his glory revealed. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified, freeing forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day! Oh, glorious day! One day they led him on Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering and anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. Hands and nations stretched out on a tree. Took the nails for me. He's living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, on the glorious day. One day the grave could conceal him no longer.
One day the stone rolled away from the door.
Then he arose
over death he had conquered.
Now he's ascended, my Lord evermore. Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him. Rising again, living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day.
Amen. Receive this benediction. May the Lord Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit and to the honor and glory of God the Father, bless you, keep you, and just give you the strength to place your total foundation of faith upon Him. Not to carry that weight on your own, but to let Jesus Christ be the foundation of your faith, your Lord and your Savior, so that you can go from this place and make disciples in His name. Amen.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Don't forget the fundraiser today. They'll have to-go boxes if you want to get your meal to go, but go up there and support Mac at the school cafeteria today. Thank you.